But I know all of my cousins. Who's Susan? Hi, I'm Dexter, and let's talk Caribbean genealogy. Did you know that nearly 40 million people have taken a DNA test for genealogy purposes? There are so many different options and there are so many things to choose from that it's a bit difficult to know exactly what you should get. In this video, I'm going to walk you through what DNA is and how you can use it to help trace your Caribbean ancestors. If you watch this video to the end, I'm going to share some tips on how you can choose the right testing kit and right testing company that will best serve you in your research. So, what's DNA? DNA, it's a blueprint for how our organs and our cells actually function, and it's like a list of instructions and a manual for how the various processes in the body actually work. And also, this encodes for our physical characteristics, so how we look and some traits. You need to understand some basics about DNA. Your DNA, it's housed inside your cells in your chromosomes, and chromosomes, they come in 23 pairs in human cells. So 22 of the 23 pairs of chromosomes are the autosomes, and the sex chromosomes, the X and the Y, as you would know. The default setting in humans is actually female, and if a Y chromosome is present, then that codes for male biological sex. How do DNA testing kits actually work? When you make your order and you get your testing kit, then you will spit into a tube, or you would take a swab of your cheek, and that's gonna take some of the cells that are inside there that will contain your DNA. There's a bit of liquid that's in there that stabilizes the cells, so when you pop them into the post and they arrive to the laboratory, that they're intact. Once they arrive there, they do a process to break up the cells to release the fragments of your DNA, and after they do that, they amplify the fragments to have many more bits of material to make it much easier to analyze the data captured within the DNA. And they use something called polymerase chain reaction, or PCR. After they've done the PCR, then they do a series of chemical reactions to be able to identify the base pair, so the ACGT, and then they decode that information to sections that we call SNPs. This is done using computers and algorithms to speed up the process, because you know, you can't imagine sort of like counting every single base pair. That would just be like ridiculous. It would probably take you 10 years before you get your results. So how do DNA companies estimate my ethnicity? Well, the clue is in the name. Estimated ethnicity is an estimate, and that means this is not a hard and fast thing. And the way how they do this is by using a reference panel. So in the reference panel, they have a number of individuals that have very well documented family trees going back many, many generations. But more importantly, these are individuals that are deeply rooted within a particular community, region, or country. And that's quite powerful. If you can trace your lineage going back hundreds of years in the same location, then you're very likely to be a particular ethnic group in that location. This is based on hard documentary evidence as well as documented oral histories that have been written down. What they do when you do your test, they look at your DNA sequence and they compare you against the reference panel of individuals. So as they get new people coming into the reference group, the reference panel itself can change, and therefore it's possible that in the future your ethnicity estimate might change ever so slightly. Without going into too much detail on this, they've got a reference panel of people that can trace their family history back hundreds of years in a particular location, and they compare your DNA with those individuals. So humans, we're actually really similar to one another, and the variance between different groups is actually really small. It's only 0.1% to 0.4% variation in DNA between individuals. So that person you sat next to on the train, you've got 996 in 1,000 similarity with that individual. And so we're only looking at really small differences, and the DNA companies, instead of looking at your entire genome, you're only looking at the areas that are known to be variable in humans. So this is how they can do your genome sequencing pretty quickly, because they're just looking at the small variations, and they're looking specifically at these what we would call polymorphisms that are linked to particular SNPs. So they look at all of your chromosomes one by one, and they're looking for different areas that they know map to particular characteristics or that are clustered within particular areas in terms of geography to get your ethnic group. So how does DNA matching work, and is this for real? Is it legit? When you do your DNA test, you also get real matches with people that have also done a test. So you get your DNA cousins this way. And similarly with the reference panel, you're being compared with all of the other people that have done a test. What they're looking at is the similarity in the genetic material that you share with those individuals, and they express that as a percentage of the shared DNA that they can identify. They express that in and quantify that using a measure called the centimorgan. And so if you have a high centimorgan, then you're a really close relative. And if it's a small number of centimorgans, then it's a more distant relative. Similarly, the length of the DNA segment is really important, because if you've got a long DNA segment, then that means that it's likely that this was something that was quite recent. And if it's small, the length of the segment, then it's likely that it would be a common ancestor from the more distant past. Now, every company does this a little bit differently. Their algorithms are trained on different data sets. Their data are also based on different reference panels, and it can be a little difficult to understand why, if you test with one company, you might have one result and then something a little bit different on another. And it's just because the way how their computers are calibrated, pretty much. So just need to understand that. I think it's really important to talk about what DNA does not do, because I know that if you're watching this, you've probably watched loads and loads of reaction videos of people looking at their ethnicity estimates. You will not get a special magical tree that's just going to just appear with everyone taking you all the way back to Adam and Eve. That's not how this works. Before you do this test, you really must do a family tree. It's essential, because you're going to get all of these matches. You're not going to have a clue exactly how you are related to them, and it may just bring more questions than answers. Your matches are typically not pre-sorted for you, so you need to say, okay, I think this is father's side, this is mother's side, and you really have to have a tree to look to see if the name of that person, the surname that's there, is it, do you recognize it, or do you recognize, well, if they're in your tree, then you're like, oh yeah, that's so-and-so, that's in my tree, and then you add them. So you need to have some information. I know some of the companies will try to do some sorting for you, but it's not quite accurate, and you really need to know for yourself rather than just taking something from an estimate that the company did. So some other things to think about, it's, well, first off, cost. So the cost of running these tests, it's come down quite a lot, but it's, you know, still can be quite a lot of money. And so you need to be strategic when you do these tests. So first off, you need to understand, well, what information do I need in order to answer a specific question? And you need to be really clear. So for example, you know, is it that you're doing this just purely to get an answer on your ethnicity estimate because you think that that might be interesting to you to have that information? That's going to be very different to if you are doing it because you were adopted and you don't have any information. The next thing to consider is the elephant in the room, unexpected information. Now, this can come in different forms. Many people find a lot of information that can completely change their identity, and it can be a bit destabilizing. It's estimated that between 10 and as much as 25% of individuals have a father that's different to the one that they know to be their biological father. These are termed non-parental events, because it also can be a different mother than what you were told that you had. There are support groups and Facebook groups for individuals that come into this information, but this can be something that can just come out of nowhere, and you need to actually think, well, if I do this test, if something like that happens, do I have a support system in place? Do I have people around me that I'd be able to speak with, or can I afford to go see a psychologist to talk through what this information means and how that might change certain things? There also might be relatives that you have not had any contact with before, and this can be quite exciting. There might be someone out there, an adoptee, who is searching for their birth family, and you might be the first one to test, and you may suddenly get a message from someone saying, oh, we're a really high match, I was adopted, can we talk? Are you ready for that? I just did this DNA test, and there's someone that's a high match that just came. They're like 900 centimorgans. I need to call Granny right now. Something's not right. But who's Susan? You also need to consider the privacy and security of your data. You must look in detail about any company to understand exactly what they will do with these data, how this is going to be processed. Is it going to be accessible by any third party, so law enforcement, or is it going to be sold on to companies developing medicines? Better companies, they have an informed consent process where there's a number of forms that you've got to look through and give your consent if they're going to be processing your data for research purposes, which is a great thing. And I would like to encourage more people from the West Indies to take part in research so that we can get a more representative view of our history. But you just need to be aware that some companies, they're great and they're really transparent, and others are not. Right, so you've watched this far and now you get a bonus. The various testing companies, they have different pros and cons depending on what you're looking for. So if you are just starting out and you're not quite sure what to do, do your family tree first before you do a DNA test. And you want to go up to your grandparents, and ideally you really want to get all eight great grandparents. And the reason for this is that you will get different branches of the family that will come up, and you may not understand how you relate to them if you don't have those additional generations in place. You also want to actually add the siblings of your parents and grandparents as well, so that you can have a wider view. For your great grandparents, you may not know all of their siblings, and that's okay. You might discover that later on in your research. The only caveat to this advice is if you are adopted and you don't know anything and you don't have access to your original birth certificate, then you will have to start off with DNA and hope and pray that someone is going to be kind enough to share information with you so you can track down your birth family. I would suggest that you start off with a company like Ancestry DNA. They've tested about 20 million people. Although they're more US focused, there's actually quite a good amount of coverage of West Indians that have tested there. You'd get your ethnicity estimate and then you will have matches. If you are searching for your birth family, I would start off with Ancestry to begin with, as it has a larger catchment group. Now, if you've already got some information about your ethnicity and you are a little bit unclear about some things, I would suggest testing with living DNA. The reason for this is that, well, they're a smaller company, they're based in the UK, and their reference panel, however, it is spectacular. It's quite detailed for people that have larger portion of their ancestry coming from the British Isles, but they've also got an incredible African ethnicity reference panel. They are able to give you some very, very detailed information going down to the ethnicity and down into the tribe level. So you'd be able to actually understand which particular African ethnicity you've got, and you'd be able to identify with a particular culture there. So this is something that's quite special, and I would suggest that if you are more interested in looking out for that information, I would start with living DNA to begin with. Because it's a smaller company, you will not get many DNA matches. So if you're searching for a birth family, don't use this one. They also do by DNA, so paternal line, so the Y chromosome coming down from father to father to father to father. You can only do this test if you are male. If you're female and you want to trace back your paternal line, then you'd want to get a directly related male relative, so a brother or a cousin to do this, or your father if he's alive. Similarly, you can, if you want to go into a bit more detail on that and you're trying to really find a paternal line Then family tree DNA, they do a Y DNA test, which is a good starting point. My heritage, they are much more globally focused. And although they're tested, fewer people, so about 5 million. So you may have people from Ireland or in Australia or New Zealand or people that are in the Caribbean or in different places in Europe. And so it's useful. I wouldn't do it the first test that you do, just primarily because it's a smaller group, and if you're looking to connect with others, then you won't get as many matches. African Ancestry, that testing company, they've got about 750,000 people that they've tested, and they've got a good reference panel for looking at West Africa especially. The service is much more expensive than Living DNA, so if your budget is a bit tight but you still want to get that information, I would suggest testing with Living DNA to begin with. What's really neat about African Ancestry is that they also give you a certificate for your highest match in terms of your African ethnicity and the tribe name, so that you can identify with that. They also link you up with people that would be able to organize heritage tours, so that you can actually go and visit a particular tribe that you come from in Africa, which I think is quite cool and I would love to do that one day. Now, a lot of you are probably asking about 23andMe. Why haven't you mentioned it? I actually don't recommend 23andMe for Caribbean genealogy for a number of reasons. First off, although they have tested about 11, nearly 12 million individuals, the focus is not genealogy for them. They're purely doing this to be able to get data to make personalized vitamins and medications. And when you do the health profile, yes, they have an informed consent process, but you need to look at the list of things that they're testing for. You may find out that you've got a gene that makes you much more likely to have particular types of cancer or neurological conditions. And I've had a number of cases where people, they got upsold from just doing the ancestry to do the ancestry on health, and they weren't really that interested in the health, but they just did it because it was on sale. And then they found out that they're double homozygous for APOE4 gene, which has an 80% chance of you developing Alzheimer's disease. And this person's young, and now they're gonna have to spend the next decade worrying about when their Alzheimer's disease is gonna start. So if you don't want to know all of that, please do not do the health information. Talk with a medical professional if you want to do that health information, because you don't really have any support. The company is just giving you the information. They're not gonna pay for you to go and see a psychiatrist because you're like, oh my god, my life is gonna end soon. However, if you're a fitness enthusiast and you are just trying to get information specifically about how you can improve your nutrition and improve your performance, and the conditions that are best for you based on that health profile, then by all means, then this is probably the thing for you. Thank you for watching. I know this was a lot of information, but just follow these general rules. What we've covered in this video, we've looked at what DNA is, we've looked at how your DNA sample is extracted and how they use the information to determine your ethnicity estimate, how they do DNA matching, and ended with some tips on how you can choose the right test for your circumstances. If you like this video, please hit the like button. Just subscribe. You've watched all of this video. You know you want to subscribe. If there's anything that you'd like me to cover in a future video, please leave a comment down below and let me know. So, see you on the next one.